Diabetes, turns out, can be found in many species. So it's not only humans who develop diabetes, but if you treat non-human primates, monkeys, with the diet that we eat, they will also get diabetic. We use rodents and other animal models like fish, flies, and worms in the laboratories to study diabetes, and you can make them diabetic just by exposing them to a certain type of diet. And so this is not a condition or a health condition that only affects humans. It's essentially a part of nature. And you can find it everywhere where you look. And the question then becomes, is diabetic metabolism a product of evolution if it goes so far back? And does it help with survival of the species, or is it just simply a mistake? So is there a connection between our body's response to become diabetic or other species' response? Is there a connection between that and maybe just simple survival of the species? And one of the most illustrative examples of the preservation of species is that it doesn't matter that the individual survives. It's mainly the propagation of the genetic information, and that was encapsulated in this term, the selfish gene. And so this is essentially the basis of reproduction and fertility, that the gene, the genetic material, gets propagated. And this reproduction function and fertility requires most of the other functions of the organism, including that the organism can eat enough, so sufficient nutrition. And this all has to do with survival of the individual, but it serves ultimately the higher purpose of propagating the genetic material of a species and preserving that species. So if we think about this and go to a certain scenario where you have here a gazelle somewhere in Africa grazing, and essentially it's eating, right? And what's happening is that when it eats, serum glucose, blood sugar, rises because carbohydrates are being digested in the grass. And when blood sugar goes up, in response to that, insulin is secreted, and the blood sugar is brought back down. Now, high glucose is not a good thing if it stays high, and you'll hear later today why. Lots of complications, and low glucose is not good because then the brain stops functioning. The brain needs enough glucose. So in response to this high glucose, serum insulin is secreted, and the glucose is brought back down. And this is where insulin works. Insulin comes from the pancreas. It stimulates incorporation of sugar in skeletal muscle. It increases the uptake of sugar in the liver, and it inhibits the breakdown of fat. And that all together in concert brings the blood sugar back down after a meal. And so in this gazelle, we have insulin levels that are high, glucose levels that are controlled. 2 minutes later, this is happening. So the gazelle is running, and it's being chased, and it has to survive. So this is the situation where survival of the species becomes important, right? And what we find in this gazelle is that hormones such as cortisol, norepinephrine, and glucagon, these are all stress hormones, they're elevated. And in this situation, glucose levels must remain high, and insulin levels that would bring blood sugar back down have to be suppressed so that sugar stays high and the gazelle can use that sugar to run. So this is a situation, essentially, that is the same pattern that we define as type 2 diabetes. So this state of fight and flight in the gazelle is essentially akin to what we ultimately in clinics called type 2 diabetes. And the same thing is, by the way, applies to the cheetah that are following, chasing this gazelle. They're actually also in this transient state of a metabolic condition that we would call type 2 diabetes. Now, this is transient. This is not a disease, but this is the same pattern that we find in type 2 diabetes. And so how does this all connect together? So diabetes, is there a connection between reproduction and fertility and diabetes? And is there actually a connection between diabetes and survival? So this transient state of diabetes essentially would help this gazelle to survive. And so if we look at these stress hormones, cortisol has been known to elevate blood sugar, and high cortisol levels cause diabetes in certain individuals. High norepinephrine levels do as well. But glucagon caught our attention back when we were thinking about this. And just to tell you a little bit about glucagon, it also comes from the pancreas, from the islets of Langerhans, just like insulin. It does the opposite to what insulin does. It stimulates blood sugar sugar release from the liver, and it stimulates the breakdown of fat to mobilize energy so that the liver can make enough sugar for the rest of the body, especially for the brain. Now, high glucagon levels are found in individuals who have type 2 diabetes. And so this is a schematic that you might encounter because it's in many textbooks. There's a person who is exercising on the right, is insulin sensitive. Their organism doesn't need a lot of insulin to control sugar. And the person on the top right of the graph is insulin resistant. It's a couch potato. And the curve that you see from A to B is how much insulin a beta cell releases. And so insulin-sensitive people require less insulin to control their blood sugar. Insulin-resistant people require more. And this is where the benefit of exercise, for example, is illustrated. Now, in diabetes, what happens is that the response of insulin release departs from this curve and moves from B to C, which is then impaired glucose tolerance. There's just not enough insulin being produced. And from C to D, where then blood sugars get out of control, blood sugar levels get out of control, and that ultimately is called diabetes. And in these conditions, in C and D, glucagon levels are elevated. And so we have this hypothesis that glucagon, this essentially a stress hormone, that is supposed to keep blood sugar levels high, that it actually might be causing this insulin production to be suppressed. Just like in the gazelle, where the fight and flight situation actually demands that blood sugar levels stay elevated and insulin levels get suppressed. So this transient state of diabetes, would this be possible that glucagon is actually causing this in the organism? And to actually, so the hypothesis says that glucagon stimulates a signaling pathway in the liver that then causes beta cells to fail. And we tested that. We made a mouse where this signaling pathway is activated in the liver, and we take its serum or plasma and put it onto islets of Langerhans. And just look at how much insulin do these islets of Langerhans release. And as you see on the graph over there on the right, the plasma of these mice with the activated glucagon signaling only in the liver suppresses insulin secretion. That's that dark black bar, the second one from the left. And this activity, this suppressive activity, can be diluted away. So if you dilute the plasma, this activity goes away. So there's something in the circulation of these mice that is stimulated, that is probably coming from the liver, stimulated by glucagon signaling, that inhibits insulin secretion. So essentially what we would expect in that gazelle. So to find that, we use a method called we use a gene expression array, just like a little chip with all the genes that are known, and we see what are the changes between these two different mouse models. The one that we have the activated signaling versus its control counterpart. And we identified this gene that is highly expressed in the liver. Surprisingly, it's called, it's this gene that is called KIS1, and it codes for a protein called KISspeptin. I'll tell you what that is in a little bit. And if we take a mouse and inject KISspeptin into that mouse, its insulin secretion, that's on the bottom right panel, is suppressed in response to blood sugar. So we can elevate blood sugar in this mouse, but when this mouse gets KISspeptin, its insulin secretion is suppressed, essentially mimicking what we have postulated to occur in the gazelle running away from the cheetah. So what I've shown you now is that in the liver, glucagon signaling, glucagon comes from alpha cells in the islets, stimulates in the liver the production of glucose, but it also stimulates KISspeptin, so a third hormone in this loop, and this KISspeptin inhibits beta cells from secreting insulin. And remember, glucagon levels are elevated in diabetes. So what we think is that glucagon starts the process in type 2 diabetes. And this is documented in epidemiologic studies that people who are at risk of becoming diabetic, they actually have elevated glucagon levels. So we have this situation where the liver is being told to increase blood sugar, and at the same time, the signal comes out from the liver to suppress insulin secretion so that blood sugar levels can rise. KISspeptin was discovered in the hypothalamus, and it regulates gonadotropin release, and it regulates puberty and fertility. So that's where this connection suddenly becomes apparent. It was discovered in Hershey, Pennsylvania, and the scientist back then decided to name his favorite peptide, KISspeptin, after Hershey's Kisses. It has nothing to do with sexuality. It has purely to do with chocolate. So humans lacking KISspeptin are infertile. And humans with KISspeptin receptor mutations are infertile. And there's very little known at this point whether they're protected from diabetes. We don't know that yet. That would be interesting to find out, but there are very few of these patients. But what I've shown you now is that there is a connection between diabetes and survival. And this is a three-way connection because it also includes the ability to reproduce and it includes fertility. And it's essentially a mysterious revelation for us. It was quite surprising. And just to close off, what we are thinking going forward is that this one peptide that we found that is circulating and regulates the beta cell, which is here in the middle of this schematic, there are probably many more circulating peptides that are regulated and that in turn regulate beta cell function and the response of the beta cell to secrete insulin. And so this is just a schematic showing you what is known so far. So there are signals from the brain, obviously, but then there are signals from adipose tissue up in the top left. There are signals from the intestine. Some of the signals from the intestine are actually used as treatment for diabetes. They stimulate beta cell function, for example, GLP-1 and GIP. And then there are signals from skeletal muscle. And there are already, since this schematic was published earlier this year, there are three more peptides that have been described that regulate beta cell function. So I think in the future, what the scenario looks like from the perspective today is that there are many more peptides that regulate beta cell function, and their balance might be determining whether somebody slips into diabetes or or not. I think this is my last slide. I'll close here.